killed John F. Kennedy? An examination of the questions written and read by Martin Fido. Part 1. An open and shut case. November the 22nd, 1963. The date most people remember. The day about which almost everybody old enough recalls where they were when they first heard the news. The moment which has been described unforgettably, when car after car after car on the American highways suddenly slowed down and pulled quietly over to the verge, as drivers heard on their radios that President John F. Kennedy had been shot in Dallas, Texas. A tragic, traumatic moment for the whole world. The end of a dream. A dream of new, youthful, idealistic politics, exemplified in the Peace Corps, U.S. government imitation of the Swiss-founded International Voluntary Service for Peace. Youth work camps through which the generosity of young people from the Western world was harnessed to aiding the deprived in the developing world. A dream of America itself. United as it had never been, with its first Catholic president proving that the electorate had put behind it the old divisions and hatreds that ruled out Irish Americans as disloyal drunken paddies. "Rum, Romanism, and rebellion," the Republican James P. Blaine had said of the Democrats in the 19th century, thereby losing his own election in a flood of Irish immigrant votes, but equally laying down the marker of prejudice which would later prevent New York's Catholic mayor, the happy warrior Al Smith, from going on to become president of the USA. The guilty knowledge that religious bigotry as much as anything had sent Quaker Herbert Hoover to the White House in 1928 festered in America's conscience for 30 years, to be exorcised when the young Catholic junior senator from Massachusetts carried the Democrats to victory over Republican Richard Nixon. Young. That was the keynote of Kennedy's appeal. Although he was effectively the same age as Nixon, and both had served in World War II, he seemed of a different generation. Kennedy, outdoorsy and active in Navy whites, had been the hero who rescued his PT boat crew from a disaster. Nixon had built his personal financial base by running a non-stop poker game for grounded air crews in the Pacific. Kennedy had entered politics as the debonair grandson of popular Boston Democrat Honey Fitz, the singing politician. Nixon had gouged and smeared liberals Helen Douglas and Jerry Voorhees to force his way into Californian political life. Kennedy was slim, boyish, one of a whooping, clannish family that played lively touch football together on the dunes of their seafront estate on Cape Cod. His voice could rise to a note of spontaneous enthusiasm, pitched as if it had just broken in adolescence, and all the promise of life lay ahead. Nixon was heavy, jowly, his favorite sporting activity watching pro football on the TV. His voice was snarling and gravelly, or artificial and unconvincing in its studied imitation of sincerity. It suggested all too clearly his years of ambition and planning and infighting as a mistrusted and unpopular vice president, whose partisan aggression and near corruption blotted the scutcheon of the amiably aging golfer Eisenhower. Forgotten were the ways Kennedy had disappointed his admirers, the catastrophic Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba, the failure to get reform legislation past a recalcitrant Congress. Remembered were the triumphant handling of the Cuban Missile Crisis negotiations and the purple passages of oratory composed by his speechmakers but given hope and resonance by his impassioned delivery. "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask rather what you can do for your country." And, "Ich bin ein Berliner." And suddenly, the hope was ended. There would be no Kennedy second term. No decade of the 60s dominated by charm and cultivation and boyish optimism. Now Lyndon Johnson was president, the ugly American in person, the reactionary Texan wheeler-dealer inflicted on the Kennedys as the career Poll's price for JFK's nomination. In November 1963, there was no expectation that LBJ would prove one of the greatest of all domestic reformers, carrying Kennedy's liberal program triumphantly and driving racial discrimination right out of official American public life. The assassination of John Fitzgerald Kennedy was traumatic as no assassination had been since Lincoln's. The last thing on earth that anyone expected was that it should remain a running sore of mystery and speculation for another 30 years. For the case seemed to be solved immediately and accurately. The first story to be carried across the world in news flashes was that President Kennedy had been shot in Dallas and was in hospital in a critical condition. This was deeply shocking, even though some trouble in Texas had been expected. Kennedy's formal visit was pure politicking. He faced a difficult fight for re-election in 1964. His first years of office had not fulfilled the hopes whose standard he bore, and there was no guarantee that he would be returned for another 4 years of style without much content. Texas was an important state in presidential races, with 22 votes in the Electoral College. He had barely carried it in 1960, and then only because his Texan running mate had pulled out all the stops, calling in debts and promising favors, as he had always done throughout his political career. In 1964, Kennedy would be his party's inevitable nominee, and there was no obvious likelihood that he would reappoint unpopular Lyndon Johnson as his vice presidential partner to help swing the Lone Star State. The November visit to Texas was intended to bolster the president's personal appeal to Texans. Not all of them had anticipated his coming with enthusiasm. The day before Kennedy came to Dallas, a black-edged, full-page advertisement in the Dallas Morning News sarcastically welcomed the president with jeering questions about his supposed abandonment of the USA's traditional domination of the Americas and the Caribbean, and his yielding to the spirit of Moscow. It was actually the work of the young New York carpet salesman Bernard Weissman, who signed it, and two of his friends, whose grandiose plan was to infiltrate, unify, and control all the right-wing organizations in America. But they had begged the paltry couple of $1,000 needed to finance the ad from three Texan oil millionaires, and it was loosely feared that hostile demonstrations or offensive placards might mar the president's trip, as a hooting, spitting crowd had recently disrupted a visit to Texas by America's UN ambassador Adlai Stevenson. In the event, Texans displayed the beautiful personal manners on which Southerners pride themselves, and Kennedy's visits to Houston and San Antonio passed off without incident. In Dallas, cheering crowds lined the pavements as the presidential motorcade passed down Main Street, and when it slowed for the turn from Houston Street into Elm Street at Dealey Plaza, Kennedy confronted the sort of odd personal demonstration of dissatisfaction that might satisfy an individual that he had made his protest without offensively raining on other people's parade. Though it was a fine day, Louis Witt had carried his umbrella to Dealey Plaza. As the president's car approached him, he began to open and close it fiercely, a form of heckling in his view, though so eccentric that Kennedy might even have thought it an odd form of appreciation had he noticed. And just as Louis Witt flapped his umbrella for the first time, the shots rang out that really did instantly echo round the world as radio and television carried the news everywhere. And the world waited with bated breath, desperately hoping that news would come that the president's doctors expected him to pull through. Even right-wing Republicans felt a sense of shock and shame that such a thing could still happen in America, as 10 years later, even left-wing Democrats felt disgraced when Kennedy's rival, Richard Nixon, resigned the presidency, having been conclusively exposed in abusing his office and lying to Congress and the country. Within 10 minutes of the first bulletin came the second news flash. President Kennedy was dead. American television switched all its channels immediately to non-stop news from Dallas and stayed there or with the president's coffin and family for the next 48 hours. Within an hour and a half of the assassination came the reassuring news. Dallas police had arrested a suspect, a young white male who had shot a policeman in Dallas sometime after the shooting of the president. As this news was reported, it seemed strong evidence that the right man had been picked up immediately. Listeners in America and abroad pictured a fugitive pulling his gun as he tried to escape from rapid police pursuit. Although the full story turned out to be rather different, it still all pointed to the undoubted guilt of Lee Harvey Oswald. The young man had been working in a building overlooking the presidential motorcade. He was the sole employee there to have left the vicinity immediately after the shooting, taking a bus and taxi back to his lodgings in a Dallas suburb. There he had quickly picked up a jacket and hurried away. Shortly afterwards, a police patrol car had stopped him in a residential area, and after a little conversation, Oswald had pulled a pistol and killed Patrolman Tippett. When police cars raced into the area, the manager of a shoe shop on a street 5 blocks from Tippett's murder site had seen Oswald suspiciously turning his back and hiding in a shop doorway before diving into a cinema behind the ticket seller's back as she came out to see what the commotion of sirens and flashing lights portended. When police were summoned to the cinema, Oswald again pulled a gun before he was overpowered and arrested. Back at his workplace, the Texas School Book Depository on Dealey Plaza, more evidence against Oswald accumulated. On the floor where he'd worked at the end of the morning and was the last person to remain at the lunch break just before the presidential motorcade came by, a sniper's nest of book boxes had been arranged. Oswald's palm print would be found on one, where the sniper had apparently sat and supported himself on his arm. Hidden among other boxes nearby, police found a Mannlicher Kakano rifle. Oswald, it would prove, had bought it by mail order using a false identity. His palm print was on the rifle. 3 ejected shells lay on the floor by the window, showing where the sniper had shot 3 times. Workers, spending part of their lunch hour on the floor below, had actually heard those cases fall on the floor above them after each shot. Although one worker had eaten his lunch in the sniper's room and left chicken remains and a soda pop bottle near the nest, it was clear that he was quite unaware of the purpose of the pile of boxes around the window or the presence of anyone hiding behind them, and he had left the room before the motorcade came by and the shooting started. No one else had been near the sniper's nest. No other part of the Texas Book Depository showed any signs of having been used by any assassin. Lee Harvey Oswald had evidently acted on his own. The sole gunman. A lone nutter. Now, this conclusion was both reassuring and overwhelmingly probable. 3 previous American presidents had been assassinated, Lincoln, Garfield, and McKinley. All had been killed by lone nutters. Although Lincoln's assassin, John Wilkes Booth, had associated with co-conspirators who were, like him, disaffected Southerners, furious at the slaveholding Confederacy's loss of the Civil War their secession had provoked, the actual conspiracy had intended to kidnap Lincoln in the forlorn hope that the Northern Union might thereby be blackmailed into yielding the fruits of the victory won at such immense cost. Booth had broken away and acted on his own in deciding to shoot Lincoln in the presidential box at the theatre. He demonstrated his own nuttiness by his actions immediately after the shooting. He leapt from the box to the stage, a piece of swashbuckling that broke his leg, and pretentiously shouted in Latin, "So perish all tyrants!" Furthermore, when the authorities tracked him down a week later, Booth alone among his co-conspirators resisted arrest to the point of fighting it out to the death, and so cheated the gallows. Charles Guiteau, who shot President Garfield in 1881, was a disappointed nutter who believed he should have been rewarded with the spoils of office after Garfield's election. Guiteau's contribution to the Republican triumph had been precisely nil. He had submitted unsolicited and unusable propaganda material to the campaign and was a balmy nonentity in the eyes of the politicians he thought should be grateful to him. President McKinley was shot by anarchist Leon Czolgosz in 1901. At the time, certain continental anarchist extremists believed that terrorism and assassination were important political weapons against what might now be called the establishment or the industrial military complex. But only in the case of attempts on the Tsars of Russia, universally perceived as tyrannical autocrats, would the assassination of a head of state command general approval. In fact, American anarchist groups had publicly warned of the danger from disaffected individuals in general, and Czolgosz in particular had been described in the anarchist press as a dangerous crank who might even be a police spy. Attempted assassinations of heads of state in the established democracies or constitutionally controlled monarchies were almost invariably the work of individuals with real or imagined grievances. The tiny group of silly individuals who associated with Booth, and the tiny family group of silly pacifists who plotted to poison Lloyd George in 1917, were the nearest either Britain or America had come to seeing a serious assassination conspiracy. Full-blown, properly financed assassination plots and plans by groups of the rich and powerful, or by any organised political party, have never been known in the Anglo-Saxon world, setting aside the activities of Irish terrorists, who regard themselves as national freedom fighters, and who, until the mid-20th century, were always disavowed by the political interests they purported to support. So there was every reason to suppose that this assassination, too, would prove to be the work of a demented individual. There were indeed strong political reasons for hoping this would be the case. No one in his right mind could welcome the idea of a combination of disaffected oil millionaires using their wealth to eliminate politicians and statesmen they disliked. Right and left alike in America cherish the democratic traditions of the country and do not wish to see electorally chosen leaders destroyed by gun or bomb, however much they may dislike their policies. And it was even more desirable that this killer should not have been set in place by any of America's Cold War antagonists. President Kennedy's success in the Cuba crisis had humiliated Khrushchev, but with the USA and USSR both wielding the nuclear threat, it was devoutly to be desired that the KGB had not decided to overstep the usual silently agreed limits and essay the revenge killing of the president. Fortunately, Khrushchev always appeared sane, if volatile. And many right-wing Americans who might normally have been the first to suspect Russia actually saw Kennedy as benefiting the Soviets more than his own country, as their ad in the Dallas Morning News indicated. True, a very few people close to the inner circles of power knew that Fidel Castro had good personal reasons to want the Kennedy administration overturned by fair means or foul. But it seemed grossly unlikely that he would take such extreme action without his Russian paymaster's consent, and equally unlikely that they would grant it. So J. Edgar Hoover was not acting impulsively or dishonestly or self-interestedly or on behalf of a cover-up when he instantly concluded that the assassin had been caught and focused the FBI's energies on assembling evidence against Oswald to the exclusion of looking for alternative suspects or co-conspirators. November the 22nd, 1963, was the day the president was shot. It was also the day, it seemed, when his murderer was caught in an open and shut case.